2NURFM, a broadcast service of the University of Newcastle.
This is a very interesting topic. I've been looking forward to chatting with our Professor of Education, John Fischetti, because he told me before we start, we can't go back in time, we've got to look forward. I'm talking about mobile phones being used in the classroom. And John, I guess when I went to school, and certainly when you, there were no mobile phones, there were no computers, but now everyone seems to have their mobile phone. Are they just a source of distraction, or do we need to think of them as any other educational tool and learn to use them right in our schools?
Yeah, well, good morning, Mark. I think this is a really provocative topic because I think probably everybody's right. The real issue is the new technology gives us boatloads of resources that are available to use in the classroom. Imagine in our day if there were YouTube videos that explain the concept a teacher was just sharing, or there's resources. We don't even have to go to the library, we have it. But because so many young people are addicted to the screens and to all of the other social media components that we really don't want, some schools are actually banning them. Tasmania's got a proposal to ban mobile phones in the classroom. Other parts of the world have. Other parts have actually figured out a way to negotiate this. And I think we're going to have to find a progressive way forward on this topic.
There's probably a middle ground because I think, as you said, banning them, and we'll see what the Tasmania experiment looks like. Maybe that's just not going to work, is it? Because, like you said, you're on the internet. It is the encyclopedia. It's the library. It is the world's resource. It's probably fair to say that the kids aren't sitting in the back calling their mates in the other classroom. They're not all probably even messaging. It's really just the online issue, isn't it?
It's the distractive nature of just going wherever, which isn't really on topic. It's the social media component, which is really just wasting time. And it's also the addiction, because our brain gets so fixed to it. It's like chewing gum or smoking. We just do it because it's a habit. So what we have to do is build this in as a literacy skill. It's a digital literacy skill of when do we use them and when do we not. And schools all around the world are trying to find that middle balance. The tricky part of what we know is if you're online in a wireless situation, you have access to things that are probably not appropriate. And so some schools are actually now just turning their wireless off and on at various times, like you would go to the library in my day, and second bell, you go to the library. But with that comes some issues that come from the states that are tricky, because in fact, some schools actually want their young people to have mobile phones available to them, but off, tucked away in their backpack for the eventuation of some terrible shooter coming in the building or some natural disaster. They want people to be able to contact their families. So there is that aspect of being willing and able to communicate with your families, running late from a ball practice after school or... So I think what we've got to do is teach our young people. We're going to use them educationally, and then we're going to turn them off in between. That's the part most of us don't even get in the adult world, is I see people sitting next to one another at the restaurant texting each other, and they're right there with each other.
Well, they might be sending them a funny picture or a photograph or something like that. So that's okay, isn't it?
I guess it's okay. They could have stayed home and done that. They didn't have to go out.
Yeah, I see your point. And even back to schools, though, I mean, it could be kids could be doing something that I know I have been guilty of at least one trivia night, and that's looking up the answers when you're not supposed to be looking
up
the
answers. Yeah, that's a real component. But back in the day, that was World Book in my day, or the Britannica.
The World Book.
You know, the L was always missing. But I think we have an opportunity to also teach ethics and responsible usage. That's part of the educational journey. There are some situations where there's bullying and harassment and other forms of misuse of the tools, and that would be just no different than if people were doing that verbally, doing that with the old notes that the teacher, let me see that note. The skill set to be a nuisance hasn't changed. The tools that we have to use to be that nuisance have improved.
They have improved, if that's the right word, I guess. And I think maybe just learning to navigate the waters and say, well, look, they are a tool, they are a teaching tool, they're an education tool. Just sort of filter out the nonsense stuff. If you can navigate that, you've figured out how to do schooling, and good luck.
Yeah, and you know, we really do have to use these tools for what they are. If you and I were on a little scavenger hunt in a geometry class and we're looking around the building for geometric shapes and we're going to use my phone to video those and come back, all that sounds like progressive 21st century learning. So I think we've got to, but if we then take a video doing something inappropriate, we probably need the same level of punishment that we did when we did that just using our pencil and drawing some funny picture on the bathroom wall or something. So we have to realize that the tools have now given us more opportunities to get things wrong. We're going to have to teach our kids from day one. I see too many babies in prams with their mothers, tired of them yelling, handing them their phone. And they're nibbling on it. They're experimenting with it. We just have to find a way to turn it off. I think that's the hardest thing for most of us who get habits that we don't like, is how do you stop doing something when it's a bad habit?
If you can figure that out, you've solved, I reckon, about 80% of the world's problems. John Fischetti, thank you as always.
Thanks, Mark.